At this time, we want to welcome all those that are joining us online, and just a reminder to let you know that we have online services that we have each week. We have a Saturday morning story time that goes on at 10 a.m., but also we have a Wednesday evening service that goes online at 7 a.m., and then we have this service will be seen next Sunday morning. It'll be on at 7 a.m. also. So if we can help any of you that are online or any of that are here with us in person this day, we want to be here to serve you and to help you in any way, shape, or form that we can. We want to be there to help one another and to pray for you. So we want to welcome those that have joined us online at this time. We have a special opportunity here today, a testimonial time, really. So I'm not sure who's going to speak first, or both of you coming up. Emma, if you're going to speak, or both of you come up and share with us about the mission trip that they just returned from about a week and a half ago to the Dominican Republic. Come and share.
So I wanted to start with thanking you all for the prayers. After some trouble with the airlines, we finally got there after 3 days of traveling. So unfortunately, we missed 1 day of clinic, but we were there for the other three. So we were there for medical care. That was what we were doing. The first day, we went to a village called Guatemala. It was up in the mountains. It took about an hour to get to. It was very small, remote. We worked out of a community center right next to a school. The first half, I was doing admitting people into it, so I was getting their names, their weight, stuff like that. The second half, I started training with the pharmacy, which is very new to me because I just graduated high school, so that was a lot. And I also had to memorize medicines, prescriptions, and also a lot of Spanish and Creole, which is the language that the Haitian people speak, because we have to write instructions on the bags of how to take it, so it was a lot for the first day. The second and third day, we were working out of a church in Santo Domingo. It was a Haitian church. We had a lot of people there. I think we worked with 100 people in total between the 2 days there. I was doing pharmacy again, and by the second day, they put me in charge of the pharmacy. So that was surprising. So the first day, it was good, though. I got all of it. I had to ask Mom a few questions, but after that, I was fine. So, yeah, it was pretty good. There was a sense of calm when we were there, for me at least. I feel like I've always been appreciative of my circumstances, but that really put it into perspective. And it was very hard coming back, not very hard, but as most of you know, I work in customer service, and so coming back and watching how people in the States treat other people and how they're not very aware of like how lucky they are, that was a harder part of it, but it was really good. I have some pictures. This is the first one. It was a patient that Mom had, and she'll explain what she did in a second. We can go to the next picture. That is a picture of our room. So there was mosquito nets over our bed. Everything was open space. We didn't have any air conditioning, and the one fan on the ceiling of that picture never pointed in the direction of my bed. So that was a little bit rough the first night, and then after that it got better. That's a picture of Mom taking care, I think, of the same kid in the first picture. She had a translator in front of her, and she'll explain more about what she was doing. That's a picture. In front, the building is the church, and we're sitting in the cafeteria. It was pouring down rain because there was their wet season when we got there, and it would rain for about an hour and just flood everything every afternoon. So that's where we were sitting. And that's me in the pharmacy on the second day. The person to my, I guess that would be my right, was an intern that was helping me, but that's the day that they put me in charge, so I was very focused in that picture because I really didn't want to mess anything up. And so, yeah, that's all the pictures.
And just in closing, we appreciate again your prayers. It's very comforting knowing, like on a Wednesday, that there's Bible study happening here, and it's horribly hot. We're sweltering over there, and but just knowing that we're being thought of, we appreciate that. And again, with this trip, I'm reminded that we are not in control. Best plans laid, you know, just aren't necessarily going to happen. Em and I were trying to plan this trip for her spring break. That didn't happen. And then this was the 1 week between her graduation and everything else that needed to happen that we could plan to go. And so with COVID and the airline stuff, we still didn't know that it was going to work out. And then 2 weeks ago, we were at the airport in plenty of time per my husband. But we were still in the departures line as our plane took off. So we had to get some things rescheduled, get down there. There were some dynamics down there that were difficult. And then I ended up catching something local or from the airport. I went, I had applied going as a nurse, and so that's what I thought I was going to do. I thought I was going to get to do pharmacy. And she told me there the night before we started, oh, by the way, you're going to be a provider. And just because of my nurse practitioner certification now, and I was not ready for that. So I went back to the dorm, studied as much as I could, looked through their protocol. And so that picture is me seeing my first ever patients and writing prescriptions that my daughter filled. So it was just very, it all works out in the end, even if it doesn't go the way we think it should. And I'm reminded of, again, this verse that I used in 2010 when I was in Haiti. Whatever we go with, whatever we think is going to happen, whatever we pack, 2 Corinthians 9:8 says, "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that we need, you will abound in every good work." So he's always there, and he always shows up with exactly what we need at that moment. So thank you again.
You notice you get experience in Dominican Republic real quick there. And we're grateful that they were willing to go in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, an extension arm of our church, of doing ministry, of helping people. And that's exactly what Jesus would have us to do, whether it's here or whether it's overseas, wherever it might be. Jesus said, love people, take care of people, do good by them, the best that you possibly can. Thank you for doing that here, Carolyn, if you would lead us.
Praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name. as we continue to worship by singing hymn number 132, There Is Power in the Blood.
This time, if we could have our boys and girls to come forward. Mr. Brandon has a special message for your parents. If you need to come with them, feel free to do so. Ooh, you okay? Here comes one more.
Have a seat. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Wherever you feel comfortable.
Sit right there.
Is everyone ready for Vacation Bible School?
Yes!
Oh, man, I'm juiced up about that. All right, I have a question for you. I see some cheaters here, so I need to conceal these better. Does anyone know what this is? Not really. Does anyone know what this is? This is a level. What do you think?
A level,
that's right. So what it does... Well, this is probably a nice one, but we're going to work with this one for now. So what this does, it tells you if you're exactly straight, okay? So if you were to build a shelf for your mom or your grandma or someone.
Let's do
mom and grandma first. So see, what you do is, you see the bubble in here? So the bubble tells you if you're exactly straight or not.
Nope.
I'm not exactly straight because I'm using it by hand. But as Christians, we are to find balance. Well, it's okay. It's a tough level. So as Christians, we are to find balance. In life, we have to juggle homework, chores, but you also have to read your Bible, say your prayers, and balance. Because Proverbs 11:1 says, a false balance is an abomination to the Lord. So juggle your life, but try to stay even so that you're always the best Christian you can be. Deal? Good? Let's pray.
Yeah.
Lord, our Father, thank you for these exciting kids, Lord, and their energy. Just help us to channel that energy into serving you into a more glorified, edifying perspective of you, Lord. Be with Bible school, preside over every day. Let us do our job as teachers, leaders, and helpers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand as we continue to worship by singing hymn number 182, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Anybody here broke through?
This time, if any would like to use children's church, you'll meet right over here. God's been good to you this week and you've been blessed. I want you to look at your neighbor and you say amen. Amen. I don't think a single person in here didn't say amen. Because we are a blessed people, folks. Whether we're acknowledging it or not, we're a blessed people. I had someone this week, they're having a lot of health difficulties, not in this church, but in another community. And approached me and said, "Preacher, irregardless of what happens tomorrow or even later today, I've got to say, God's good because He's blessed me. With all these years, He's blessed me." That's a wonderful and awesome God that we serve. We were looking at some of the Bible school, VBS songs and things. We serve an awesome God that cares so much for us. I'm going to change a little bit. I have a number of scriptures always that go on. I want to switch over a little bit here. Turn with me to 2 Timothy, to the third chapter here. I think very pertinent in the age that we're living in here today. And I'm going to read several other passages of scripture, but I'll let you turn there to 2 Timothy, the third chapter. We're going to read a few verses there, but I want to share some other verses to you. With you also here. Now, one of the things we were challenging in the first service was, and let me just go over a few things here. When our hearts abandon God, and I think sometimes we do abandon our Lord, we should never, we should always search and look to our Heavenly Father and seek to walk on the path that God has laid out before each of us. Every day of our lives. That ought to be. That's the ideal. That's the state where we should be. But does that happen? Sadly, but it's true that there are many instances in which that we fail to walk where we really ought to. Now, the nation of Israel, Old Testament days, the nation of Israel many times, they listened to God, they would hear, and they'd have a season in which they would do that very thing. They would follow the leadership of our Heavenly Father. But yet we know time and time again, disobedience, the willingness or their unwillingness to hear God and to walk in the way and manner in which our Heavenly Father would have them to walk. It would happen and would occur. Now the one thing that folks, whenever we are walking adverse to what God's Word says, there are always consequences. Someone said sin will always find you out, and it does. There's no hiding anything from our Heavenly Father. He wrote the book of your life and my life. He knows us. He knows us for the good, but He also knows us for the not so good. And the wonderful thing about it, God knows us and He still loves us. And He still cares about us, and he's still seeking to keep you and I on track of where we need to be. Why does he want us on track? Because he knows if we're living our lives in the way and manner in which his word prescribes to us, just as Janelle was there writing that was your first patient there writing a script. Hey, listen, God's written a script for every one of us. He's written a direction, a calling. And many times we think calling's just ministerial or it's missionary. Listen, I believe every one of us are called. We're called of God to do what he has particularly and specifically has created us for. God's word tells us here, you know, all this debate about when and where does life begin. The Bible very clearly and distinctly says that God knew us before, while we were in our mother's womb. God knew us. Listen, God has prescribed to us what is going to make us or bring us to a position or point in your life and my life in which that we can and follow Jesus Christ or follow his direction for our lives. God is a specific God. He is looking in your life and my life and wanting us to do this. So sin does not make a better life for us, but certainly it causes the direct opposite. Sin is going to bring into us problems, even sometimes suffering. You've heard me say many times throughout these number of years that we've been privileged to be together, that sin will take us down roads much further and paths much longer than what we ever intended to go. You see, sin will take us where God's word certainly indeed is not being followed. And it will cause us heartbreak. And we think, and the world has told us, well, I'm my own person. It doesn't matter. That's the furthest thing from the truth. The sin, our sin, many times is going to affect others. It's going to bring some struggles and difficulties for those that we love that are around us. It's going to tarnish and diminish our testimony as a child of God. So let me go on and just say a few things here. Sin is a downward spiral. A theologian wrote this one day, that drives one deeper and deeper into an abyss until finally the heart grows more corrupt. You see, it gets easier as we go a little further on the path that is leading away from what God's word has prescribed for us to live. So as we go down that path, the next time, the next temptation, the next IDOL, idol, that is presents itself to us, it gets a little easier to look the other way from God's word and to look to the way of the world. You see, our heart begins to harden. Our spirit begins to literally to begin to where we get to where it seemingly we do not adhere or listen like we ought to. And our hearing spiritually gets deafened to a certain degree. So sin certainly is going to scar us. It's a scary path that we find ourselves on when we find ourselves on in a downward trend that is going not toward God, but away from our Lord. We find ourselves in a difficult fix. And many times, Satan loves it, folks. Satan is loving some of the conversations that we're having here in America today in North Carolina and Union County. Satan loves it whenever we know what's right, and yet we tolerate what is, we know that is so adverse. I told the first service that my generation, we began to see some of the influx of ideals and thinking of when Ten Commandments taken out of the schools, prayer, teachers being able to reach out and to hug their students. This is what I always liked about, I was privileged for 2 or 3 years to teach in a private school. I loved it when I had a reasonably small class, and if one of our teenagers would have a problem that morning before we ever started class. I can remember one of the things that we did at this particular school I was at. We pushed all the desks aside, and we asked every one of our boys and girls, we got in a circle on our knees, and we were praying for that person, that other fellow student, of what his or her problems and struggles that they were having, irregardless of what it was. You see, it's a good thing to be able to talk to the Lord on behalf of our brothers and sisters, is it not? That's why we say every week, we want to ask, every service we want to ask, lift your hand if you've got a prayer request. You that are joining us online, we want to pray for you, and we're praying for you. Our Heavenly Father, He knows all. And He knows what's going on in every life that we find ourselves in here today. So certainly indeed here, and it becomes easier here, there's a point where the mercy and grace of our Heavenly Father no longer moves us in the way that it used to, or when we were new in the Lord, as we allow sin to creep in or other things to be placed in between us and our Lord. So we've got to be very cautious about that. So we've got to be careful with this. Look with me here at 2 Timothy, the third chapter. We're going to read here in just a moment. Let me read a couple other passages here. Romans 15:4 says this, "For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning." God's word is given to help us. It's to show us the way. It's to show us how to handle circumstances and situations in life that sometimes are so difficult. Sometimes you think, preachers are those maybe that teach Sunday school or otherwise, that they know all the answers. No. We don't know the answers. He is the answer. We know the one who has the answer. And so it's so important here. And here in the book of Romans, we see where it says to us that the Bible, that's why the Wycliffe work is so important, of getting a copy of God's Word in people. Because the Scripture is going to help people to learn about Jesus Christ, but to learn what we're to do and how we're to live and how we're to interact. That we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, that we might have hope. We've used that term, analogy, a lot around here later. Listen, we are not a people without hope. We come here today with the people of Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and He has us in His hands. He is the way, and He is the truth, and He gives us life, not only upon this earth, but all of eternity. That's the Lord that you and I serve. Joshua would write in the book of Joshua 24:15, records these words, "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord," in other words, there are a lot of people here in America today, in Union County and our state, and all around about this world, that they really, it seems evil to serve the Lord. Now, this was not a thing that just all of a sudden came up here. It's been all throughout generations prior to us, and it will be in generations to come. But there are many that think it not right for you and I to proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We sing that beautiful hymn, "Keep Telling the Story." Folks, I don't know about you, as long as God gives me breath, I want to keep telling the story. I want to keep telling about Jesus. I want to keep, and telling doesn't always mean words. telling means that we're living and we're walking the way and manner in which is pleasing in God's eyes. I hope as you've come into God's house here today, or you're listening to us online, that you're coming seeking to walk closer to the Lord and to walk in His ways, not our ways. It's so important, folks, that we're looking and thinking about this. And here in the book of Joshua, 24th chapter says, you make this decision. He says you need to choose you this day whom you'll serve. I'm convinced that that's something that you and I need to that's a decision we need to make every day that God gives us life. I hope that as you awake every day in your life, that you're going to choose, Lord, this is your day. This is a gift you've given to me. And God, this is a gift that I'm going to take every opportunity that you afford to me to be able to carry forth the gospel in whatever way, or to reach every person, Lord, that you seek to bring across my path in the name of Jesus Christ. And this is what the writer here in Old Testament's telling us. Choose this day whom you'll serve. Is it going to be the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood? Or is it going to be the gods of the Amorites whose land that you dwell in? And they close this particular passage here, verse 15. But as for me and my house, I'm going to serve the Lord. I hope that we're going to start that way of thinking. As for me and my household, those in my family, that we're going to choose God. Hands down, there's not going to be a choice. There's not going to be another option. I choose you, Jesus. I choose you, Lord, to be Lord of my life. I choose the direction to follow you, not to follow the world, not to follow what the world is saying. And Deuteronomy says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. A lot of people think, well, this was a New Testament passage. Yes, Jesus did quote this passage. But I'll promise you it came right here from God's word. Jesus reminded those that were listening to him and following him. He said, I came not to destroy the law, but I came to fulfill it. And he said, I came to show you and to bring to life what the Old Testament, and they didn't call it the Old Testament. They'd take down the scrolls and they'd read it. And you remember what they told, what the people were told as God's word was read to them? You write God's word upon the table of your heart. Why do you want to do that? Because they didn't have notebooks. They didn't have iPads. They didn't have smartphones. They didn't have any way of writing it down. He said, I want you to put this to remembrance in your soul and life so that you can teach what God's word says to all in your family in the morning, at noon, and at night. You teach them about. Now, look with me here at 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, if you have your Bible. Now, I'm reading out of King James here this morning. Look with me. Let's look a little bit. I'm going to skip down here to verse 5. Now, I hope that you'll take time to read the first beginning of the first part of this chapter, because it does say that this know also that in the last days, perilous times are going to come. I don't know about you, but I am seeing evidence with every time I turn my computer on or TV on, I'm seeing a lot of perilous times that not only that we are facing as individuals, but our states, our counties, our nation, and our world is facing. Paul's writing to young Timothy, a preacher lad, and he's telling him, this is what you need to realize, that when you begin to see these things, these are in the last days that you're living. Look with me here at verse 5. He said, having a form of godliness. Now I wonder today, I want to challenge us. I know our time's going to get away soon. Are you seeing individuals that are having just a form of what the model is set before us here in the Bible? Are you seeing folks that are really, they're taking the framework and fitting in so-so within it? Oh, they're not trying to adhere to it specifically, but they've got it in general. God never called us to know Him in general. God called each of us, as we receive him as Lord and Savior of our lives, he called us to be specific with him and to give him our whole life, everything. Not exclude certain areas of our lives. You see, we live in a world of exclusion. When you sign a contract or you buy something, you want to look and see what the warranty covers. You better read the fine print. For in the fine print is some things that might raise your eyebrow a little bit, because that fine print is certainly almost denying any and all rights that we might have. Certainly limiting our rights as a purchaser of whatever that might be. Look at what Paul's writing, young Timothy. Verse 5 says, when those last days, which he calls perilous times, come, having a form of godliness, but look at the next phrase. But we're looking around and they're denying the power thereof. How many times do we see, whenever God has performed a miracle or done something in your life or my life or a loved one's life, do we see a naysayer? You know what a naysayer is? That, hey, we have a tendency to be negative a lot of times and look for not the positive, but look for that which might negate things. And here's what Paul's writing to young Timothy. He says, you got a form of godliness, but you're far from me. And he said that in that day, as he says, continues reading in the middle part there, you're denying the power of. That form does not do it for you. Just knowing about Jesus doesn't save anyone. You've got to know him personally from the depth of your heart and soul. You've got to give him every part of your being. And look as we continue reading here in verse 5. As if this needed to be said, but I think it very much says this needed to be said here in 2022. The last phrase here in verse 5. When you see others that are experiencing forms of godliness and they're denying who God is and not giving him the credit for that which he is doing in and about our world and our lives, here's what Paul writes to Timothy. You turn away from it. You know what Satan's loving to do, and he loves it whenever you and I, we take that turn, not toward God, but we take a turn toward worldliness. And when we turn toward worldliness, it's a gradual turn, and we slowly but surely we enter a path or a territory in which that we never really intended to go. But the longer we stay there and the further we go down that road or path, it gets easier to simply leave God out of the picture in our lives. To acknowledge, oh, I know who God is, but no, that wasn't God. I'll promise you that God is still in the miracle business today in 2022. God's hand is still and spirit is still being poured out upon this world today. Look with me at verse 6. For of this sort are they which creep into house and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lust. But look at verse 7. Ever learning. We live in a time and a society in which that we can pull up basically anything from something so small as an iPhone. Siri knows my name. My computer. Laptop. All other ways of pulling things up. We're ever learning
But what are we learning? Where are we at? Are we closer to Jesus today than we were 100 years ago? I'll promise we are days closer to Jesus than we were 100 years ago, because Jesus could come at any moment. But I wonder, are we closer to Jesus? Are we walking closer to Him? We have ways and means of carrying the gospel through the airways and online like the world could never have imagined. But are we closer to Jesus today? You see, this goes back where we get to the place we got a form of godliness, and that's enough for us. We settle for that to be enough. Is that enough for us? Certainly it shouldn't be. Look with me here as we continue verse 7. You're ever learning, but you're never able to come to really to the knowledge of what real truth is. Why are we not able to acknowledge what real truth is? It's because we choose not. There are some things I might decide, hey, I'm not gonna choose this. I don't wanna get involved in this particular thing. It's time, folks, that you and I, the sleeping giant, which is called believers or the church, it's time that you and I woke up to the simple fact that whenever there are things that are ungodly that are going on in our world, and there are a lot of different things and areas in which that is so adverse or totally opposite what God's word is that's going on in our world today, we've got to be so careful. We want to see our world closer and closer to Jesus Christ, then certainly indeed we've got to be sure that of where we're at in our walk with Jesus Christ. Look with me a little further here as we continue. That here as we see here is that the knowledge of the truth's there, but yet here we are. We're not able to come to that place. We don't get there. We do not arrive there as we really ought to. It's so important, folks, that we're realizing this. Let me share with you here a little story here, if I may. I'll challenge you a couple things here before we share this story with you. There are two words used in the Scripture, one redeem and one redemption. It's very interesting, these two words, the meanings of them. What does it mean that Jesus redeemed us from our sins? Well, the first thought is that it meant that Jesus' blood had bought us. And that's true, but it's more than that. Redeemed. Redemption. He has saved us. Jesus is still in the saving business of saving men and women, boys and girls, as we have journeyed far, far, far away from Him. Let me give you an illustration here to kind of bring this to light. Now, maybe to help us understand this story and about these words. It seems as though a young boy, this little boy's name was Tom. Tom and his father, they had built a small toy boat together. Not unlike most of us as dads, I've done things with my son, and my dad did things with me, and so they built a boat together. It took a long time for them to do it. They were very particular about it. But once it was finished, little boy said, "Dad, it's beautiful." And Tom could hardly wait for that day in which that spring would come and they could take it out on that lake or river running into the lake to try that boat out. So finally that day came, and Tom tied a string to his new toy boat that him and his dad had worked so hard on. And he placed it in the water. The little boat, as it was floating out on the water, is said that it looked so real as it floated there on the river. But suddenly a very strong current came upon the boat, and as Tom tried to pull it back to shore,
As you might know, the string broke. The little boat raced downstream, and Tom running along the shore as fast as he could. But his boat quickly but surely it slipped out of sight. All afternoon until dark, he searched for the boat. And he sadly went home without this toy boat that he and his dad had worked so hard on. A few days later, they lived in a small town. On the way home from school, Tom was passing by a shop there in the local town. Tom spotted something that caught his eye. It was a boat, just like his, in the store window. He inched up closer to the window and he looked in. Sure enough, that boat was his. So he hurried in to talk to the store manager. "Sir, that's my boat in the window there. I made it along with my dad." And the shop owner looked at him and said, "Sorry, son. Someone else brought it in this morning. If you want it, you're going to have to buy it." So Tom ran home. Pretty tough lesson to learn. And he broke his piggy bank open. And he counted all of his money. And it took everything he had and then a little more that the shop owner forgave. But he bought back the little boat that he and his dad had made. As he left the store, young Tom hugged his boat and said, "Now you're twice mine." And I want you to listen carefully to these words. "First I made you, and now I bought you." Wow. Is that not what God did for us? Did God not first make us, and we allowed sin to come into our lives? We chose sin. And what did Jesus do when he came a little over 2,000 years ago and he gave his life on Calvary, on the cross? He bought us back. Let me go a little further into this. Now, what does that tell us about redemption? Redemption literally means to buy back something. You and I have been redeemed, or we have redemption through Jesus Christ. It belonged to you, but whatever reason you had to redeem it or buy it back. That little boy owned the boat, but in order to get it back, he had to redeem it. He had to take from his piggy bank and all of his little savings that he had acquired, and he had to buy it back. Pawn shops do this all the time. People will come in and they'll pawn a watch, a computer, or what have you, or a TV to get extra money. But then, after a limited amount of time, they can come back in and they can redeem that object for the pawn price plus some interest. The person who pawned that item had owned it, but in order to get it back, they had to redeem it. Now, this is what this means to us. God made you and I. You were made in His image, every one of us. You and I literally belong to God. There are many people that do not want to recognize and believe that. But you and I belong to our Heavenly Father. We were made in His image. Then you and I, we need to begin to think just how much God loves us and He cares for us. We live in perilous times. We're ever learning, but somehow or another, as much as we learn and as much as we study, somehow or another, we never really come to real truth. We never come to grips with really what really matters. You've heard me say many times, the most important decision you and I will ever make is to come to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. That's the most important decision that you and I can make.
Most of us here today, you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. He made us, He created us in His own image. But you and I, we chose the wrong path. We chose sin. We chose to allow sin to alienate us from Him. And Jesus Christ came and He said, I've got a way for you to come back to my Father. I've got a way that you can come back from the sin and the wrong choices and the wrong paths and wrong roads that you have chosen. And it's through the sacrifice that my Son Jesus Christ has done. A lot of times we do not want to look and think about how that Jesus Christ took your sins and my sins with Him to Calvary. But He did just that. He paid the price for this old boy's sins. And rest assured, we don't have to look to the right and left to find sin. All I have to do is look within us. We're sinners. We miss the mark. Without Jesus Christ, there is no eternity. Jesus Christ, He is life. He is the way. He is truth. But you and I, we have to choose. Choose the redemptive power of Christ that Christ has said. And most of us, we know Christ, a wonderful thing, but also know that in a Christian's life, that you and I need to take a long, hard look at ourselves and how God sees us. And do we need to rededicate or recommit our lives to Jesus? This altar is open this morning. If you're visiting with us, you're in God's house this day. Will you come and invite Jesus Christ to come into your heart and life as Lord and Savior, but also to open up to Him and to say, Lord Jesus, I surrender my all to You today, and I want my life to be new again. I want to feel that newness that I once felt, that I've allowed the world to tarnish, and I've allowed the world to maybe get in between us. Lord, I want all that removed today. It starts with, what are you choosing? Like the Old Testament writer, as he said, I'm going to choose God this day. So choose you this day whom you'll serve. Will you serve Christ? Will you let Jesus Christ be your Redeemer here this morning? Will you open up to Him right now? Believer or non-believer, will you let Jesus Christ come into your life? We're going to stand and sing a brief time of invitation. Stand with me if you would, please. Will you come? Just as you are. Thank you so much for being here with us today, your attentiveness, and those that visit, we're glad to have you come back and be with us anytime you possibly can. Glad you chose to worship with us this day. Let's pray if we may. Heavenly Father, I thank You, Lord, for the opportunity and the privilege that we have of being together once again here in this Your house. Lord, that Jesus Christ is our Redeemer, and that, Father, that You provided a way and manner in which through Your only begotten Son, that every one of us could be forgiven and that we could live guided by the power and the presence of Your Holy Spirit every day of our life through the good times and those times that are not so good. You're right there with us. Lord, thank You for every family that's represented here this day. And Lord, just lead us and guide us, direct us. Be with us this week as we, here in just a matter of a few hours, we're going to be starting Bible school. Talk, may Your Holy Spirit speak to every boy and girl, that, Lord, that Jesus may be exalted and lifted up here in this Your house. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Have a wonderful remainder of the week. May God bless.